Now, we've already shown how to get the supply and demand for urban space. To figure out the overall size of the city and the cost of living in that city, we put the two together. First, demand, which might be a line, but it doesn't need to be. It just needs to slope down. Next, supply. Again, it might be a line or a curve, but it does need to slope up. The point where they meet is the market equilibrium, and that tells us what to expect about the number of homes in the city and the price of each home. But, again I hear you cry, how does the market reach that equilibrium? Economists have been expertly waving their hands about that question for over 150 years. The great Antoine Augustine Cournot first sketched these twin scissors. But it was Léon Valras, the son of one of Cournot's students, who gave us the phrase tâtonnement to suggest the groping process through which markets reach equilibrium. The basic idea is that if prices are too high and supply exceeds demand, then builders will notice an inability to sell and they will stop construction. Conversely, if prices are too low, then builders will notice that their units are being snapped up at current prices and they're going to supply a bit more. Does tâtonnement work perfectly? Surely not. But the congruence of supply and demand is a useful intellectual structure for thinking about the determinants of quantity and price in any market, including the market for homes in Gotham. So, now that we've drawn the two lines, let's think about what happens if amenities in the city improve, perhaps because the city government does better at fighting crime. The demand curve will shift up, and there will be a new equilibrium point. As you can see, prices will be higher, and the population of the city will increase. The extent to which the increase in demand is seen in prices or quantities is determined by the elasticity of building supply. To see this, let's look at two versions of Gotham. Version 1 is like Houston, Texas. There are a lot of lots, and they're pretty much all the same. Consequently, the supply curve slopes up very, very slowly. Economists call this elastic supply. When demand for Gotham increases, the price will go up very, very little. But the population of the city will rise dramatically. Version 2 is like London. It's very, very hard to add new space. Consequently, the supply curve is almost vertical. In this case, a boost in demand shows up almost entirely in rising prices, and the size of the city stays constant. The structure contains lots of simplifying assumptions, but it does explain a true fact about the world. When supply-constrained cities, including San Francisco, New York, and Boston, experience a boost in demand, either because their economies heat up or because their amenities become nicer, prices rise enormously and the size of the city population increases only slightly. When supply-unconstrained cities like Atlanta, Dallas, Houston, and Phoenix experience higher demand, again because of rising wages or improving amenities, then we see rising populations and little impact on prices. Economics 101 does really help us make sense of America's urban fortunes.